So welcome back to the channel. What we wanted to do is we did an initial ride on the Turbo R. We want to do pretty much a one-year review. I've had mine a little over a year. Damon's had his for just a little bit longer than I've had mine, or ours, I should say, because Lori's going to get upset.
Yeah, Lori's going to get
But people want to ask, what do you think about the Turbo R? What do you like about it? What do you dislike about it? Would you buy another one? And to that terms, yes, we would, because not only do we have the four-seater, Damon has his. Based off of that, Sissy went and got hurt. So when people asked, would you buy another Turbo R? Yes, I would say yes. If you're a Polaris person, then Turbo R to me is a damn good platform. And I would not buy the Pro R in a four-seater, in my opinion, based off of the wheelbase. I think the downfall to the two-seater Turbo Rs are the wheelbase. I think if you had a Pro R wheelbase and a two-seat Turbo R, it would make it 100% better, because the wheelbase does seem to be the downfall on the Turbo R two-seaters. But I do like the shorter wheelbase of the Turbo R four-seater. So kind of based off this, we've had them a year, maybe a little over a year and a month or so. I have about 750 miles on mine. Damon's a hair under 500. Cece has about 300 of hers, but she did get hers a little later than everybody else, so that kind of makes up for the shorter mileage on that. While I say that we have that mileage, some people put more, some people put less. We do ride quite a bit, but what you see in our videos is how most of our miles are, or every single mile on some of these rides. So
they're hard ass miles. They're
very hard.
Yeah.
So most people know, if you've done any studying on the Turbo R's or the Pro R's, the biggest downfall that a lot of people complain about is the trailing arms. The rear trailing arms are very large and they do hang down a lot. And I will say that that is one of the biggest downfalls to the Turbo R ride, because you can't even really put a high clearance arm on it yet, because you have to have this tow link in here. And I'll show you here in a minute, you know, the bottom of mine, and show you how beat up they really are. Trailing arm. Straight trailing arm.
You're hitting way up here. Right behind your slider on the trailing arm.
So my opinion, this part here is very hard on it, and you can see the damage that's done to mine over time. If they were able to put this to where some of this height was after the tire, it would be a lot better. But it does have a lot of flaws with this being so low on the ride. So Damon actually bought HCR trailing arms for his. And what he's saying is HCR claims that they have 2.5 inches of ground clearance more than the stock ones. The problem is your 2.5 inches of ground clearance is back here where the knuckle starts to break. Up here in front of the tire, when we installed these, it actually only gained a little over an inch, inch and a quarter. So it's about an inch and a quarter difference. And while we bring that up, I don't think it matters back here, because you're after the breakover of the tire if you're actually crawling over anything. So the point of having 2.5 inches more back here, it doesn't really help to me. And in my opinion, and me and Damon was just talking about this, in my opinion, I wouldn't spend the money on HCR to only gain an inch and a quarter, but he has said that it has helped him and he would spend the money again to buy those. So that is up to you and your opinion if you think that you would want to spend that kind of money to gain that kind of clearance. So one of the reasons that I did the research and picked a Turbo R is the Turbo R actually has a factory gear reduction in it. And I wanted that over a Pro XP or say a Razor XP, something like that, because I wanted that gear reduction to run 35s. So pretty much since this thing has been brand new, it's been on 35s and it's been on Rockzillas, and I've had no issues at all with the gear reduction, the clutching, or the belt. It works good in low, it works good in high. Sissy's been on 35s. Damon was actually on 35s with 10 wides, and Sissy's normally is as well, so you can go back and watch our videos and see that. But working with all of the stock drivetrain, we have actually done no altering to the drivetrain, and it has worked perfect on 35s. So I guess one thing I do want to bring up, all three of us do have the Ultimate Editions. The Ultimate Editions comes with the Fox live valve shocks. If you want to ask my opinion, would you buy the Fox live valve again? Yes, I would. I would spend that extra money to buy it. No doubt about it. There's no questions. In my opinion, I haven't rode one without it. If you want to run without sway bars, maybe a non-live valve would work perfect for you, because Damon here has no sway bars. He has no front sway bar, no rear sway bar, and he runs in comfort mode. So he likes to do that, so he gets a lot of flex out of it. I still actually run mine in rock mode all the time with the front and rear sway bars connected. and I've had no issues with it. The thing works perfect. Everybody says, oh, you got to take them off to get flex. I've had no problems with flex. I've had no problems with getting any grip or grab out of this thing. So I don't know if I'll ever pull the sway bars off, because in the year that we've done this and the year that I've been riding it, I've had no issues with it at all.
But with that being said, Damon on 37s and no front sway bar, he has started to rub. I don't know how good it's going to pop up on video, but you can see right here, it is starting to pull up some plastic. But Damon is on 37s where everybody else is on 35s.
Yeah, because a lot of people, since Damon's put 37s on it, everybody goes, hey, will they fit stock? Yes, they will. Damon's been on 37s for a while, and he just started rubbing this weekend. And going back to that, Damon does have MTS springs on here, and he believes that the springs are actually starting to kind of break in and being more flexible than they were from the beginning, because he's rode a few rides on this and not had any problems with the rubbing until this weekend that we're here. Another thing I want to bring up, so we've been riding for about a year, and I have broke a rear axle, and Damon has broke a rear axle at two different places and two different rides. We weren't together at the time. But one thing I will say is both of them broke, and it was actually on the spline part of the shaft and not the CV or the main axle. So they both seemed to fail in the same place. I broke mine. I think it was a real fluke, because I had a lot of wheel speed and I slammed into a root and it broke it. Damon was kind of the same thing. He had some wheel speed and kind of fell down into a rut, and it snapped his. So I don't really think it's a fault. I thought maybe the overall length of the axles would be an issue, but it doesn't seem to be a problem with these. So we have been running stock driveline. So we have still just went back with like a factory replacement axle. I don't think the axle was the fault. It was just what happened at the time of riding. One thing I did want to mention is, well, you can see that we're at a different location. So we did run out of daylight at our last deal, so we didn't get to kind of wrap everything up. So to finish it up, it's just going to be just our four-seater. But I will kind of explain anything that goes between the two-seaters and the four-seaters. One thing I will say that is a downfall to the Turbo R platform, and I believe the Pro R's as well, they do not come with a front winch. No matter if you get the base model, the premium, the ultimate, nothing. None of them come with a factory winch. So we did have to buy a winch plate from Super ATV. It is pretty nice. It has some little hooks. It hooks right into the frame, so it's easy to put in. So we did put that in there, and I just bought a winch from Harbor Freight, so it's got a Badlands winch in it. Kind of the downfall to all of that is if you do put all that in, it deletes your front bumper bar here. So myself and Damon had to do some fabrication and build a plate, cut this down and build a plate and make it mount to the top of the winch mount. So if you want a winch, you're going to lose this unless you're kind of capable to do some fabrication to put it back in. So you can see on ours, I'm still running the factory wheels. A lot of people have said, hey, you need to get bead locks. You got to have bead locks. I don't disagree with that to some point. In a year, we've only busted one bead off. And I'm not really sure how that happened. I run about 9 to 10 pounds of air in these tires. The only reason I run kind of that much is because this thing is heavy. On the old two-seaters we had, the X3s and stuff, I would run, 5 or 6 pounds. But this thing really likes 9 or 10 just based off the weight, where it's not squatting the tire down too much. But I haven't bought wheels yet, because when they switched the Turbo R and the Pro R, they went to a 5-lug pattern, and it's kind of taken some time for the wheel manufacturers to catch up. So prices are still, to me, kind of high for what I want to spend on a set of wheels. Yes, you can find some, but they are expensive. So I've still been running the stock wheels. The second reason is most wheels that you buy, this thing is already 74 inches wide, and I don't really want to go any wider than that, because it is kind of tight in some areas, and plus loading it on my trailer, I don't want to go too big to where it won't fit between the fenders. So most wheels are like a 6+1 or 4+3, or if you can go 10 wides, they're 5+5. So I'm trying to find something that will still have the 7+0 offset so that it won't get any wider than it is already. Saying that, Damon has ran, Sissy has 10 wides on hers, and Damon has in the past before he went to 37s. When you run 10 wides, these things get 84 inches wide, and that makes it really hard to load on a standard trailer or to even drive down tight trails. So as far as issues, I haven't had any issues out of mine. Damon and Sissy haven't either. They actually have two-seaters. For some reason, theirs didn't fall under a recall. The four-seater Turbo R's, and I believe the four-seater Pro XP's, fell under a recall. with the fuel pump issue, and when the recall first came out, they didn't have a fix for it. So they actually put a do not ride on this for right at 6 months. So it took us about 6 months to get the fuel pump in and get it warrantied or done under the
recall.
Recall. And then that way that it was, you know, deemed safe to ride again. So one thing I will say, we did talk about these being the Ultimate Editions, and it has the dynamic shocks. With the Ultimate Editions, it does come with the ride command and the touch screen and 7-button setup here. I do like this because you can obviously see different gauges. Your music is tied into it. You have front and rear cameras. So it actually comes factory with a rear camera. So you can add a front camera to it. I have one on this one. For some reason, when I took the deal off, maybe I unplugged it. It's not working at the moment. But you do have mapping capability, so you can track rides. You can mark locations. You can figure out how to get back to certain locations. You can do vehicle to vehicle on these too from the factory, so you don't have to buy that separate like you used to with the old ride command. So if you're riding with the group, you can put everybody on here and have them laid out to where you can tell if you lose somebody. So like I said, you have different gauges. One of the cool things is, and if you watch any of our videos, you can see the shock settings and what they're actually doing. So when you change your modes, you can actually see the compression and the rebound changing on these on the fly. So I do like running in rock mode when we crawl a lot. It does help it out. You can see obviously your miles per hour, your steering, your shocks, everything that's going with that. You can push this button here and actually see the angles that you're at, front to rear and side to side. One more thing I did want to add, the different modes do have different steering settings as well. So when you're in rock mode, the steering is actually super easy so that you can maneuver around. If you go into track mode or Baja mode, it actually makes the steering reaction tighter or harder. So your DPS is harder to turn in these modes, so it makes it easier to drive at high speeds.
So also for these Turbo R platforms, they do make a 10-inch sub. It's a Rocker Fosgate sub, but it's through Polaris. And it does add a lot of sound and a little bit of bass to your music. So, I mean, it is a really good upgrade in my opinion.
Yeah, so it's a factory deal. It's actually called the Stage 3 kit, and it comes with the built-in amp and everything, and it plugs right into your Polaris system. So it's super easy to install. We have a video on that. If you want to see it, you can go watch that video. And with the Ultimate Editions, they do come with a sound system. So it comes factory with the Stage 2. So you have dash speakers, you have tweeters on the bars, and in the four-seater, you actually have speakers in the back. The one thing I think is a downfall is on the two-seaters, you do not get the rear speakers. So you only get the rear speakers on the four-seaters. You have to buy those separate in the two-seaters. Now, just to kind of wrap everything up, we went over all the stuff you can get on this from the factory. I want to just kind of throw in a couple accessories that I have really liked or I thought was worth the money of buying. One would be the Rock Sliders. These are from Polaris. You cannot get them in purple. You can only get red or black. This was a red and black edition when we bought it. We changed it over to the purple, so I did paint these. But to buy these from Polaris, I think it's like $895 for the four-seater. The two-seater is cheaper than that, but they do go right into the frame. They have taken a beating and they have held up, so I think that is worth the money to buy these. A lot of times the factory stuff's not as good as aftermarket, but these have held up very well. Another Polaris accessory is the cooler for the Turbo R's and the Pro XP models. They are part of the lock and ride system, so they drop right in and have just some clamps that clamp it in there. While this does cost, I believe, $320, do I like it? Yes, because it does fit in there and it does work. The one downfall I think it really has is it is not very big. So it will hold probably about an 18-pack of sodas, Cokes or Dr. Pepper, something like that in there with ice kind of comfortably, and that's about really it. So I don't think it's really worth the overall money unless you can figure out some way to tie that down. And that's the reason we bought this. I've carried Yetis and everything, and I had a hard time trying to figure out how to clamp it down and hold it down to where you could still get in and out of it pretty regularly. Oh, he's got it. Oh shit, it's going over. Oh shit.
got Brent coming up a little step up here at the goat.